We are very fortunate over these three nights to have Father Fred with us. He has been with us before, and as we heard last night, and I have no doubt we will hear tonight and tomorrow night, words that are very inspiring, very hopeful, and very helpful in helping us to enter more deeply into the season of Lent. Many of you have heard me say in the past, Lent is one of my favorite seasons. I love Lent. I think Lent is awesome. I love everything about it. And part of that is because it is sort of one big retreat, one big opportunity to really focus on our relationship with Christ, to focus on our relationship with ourselves, particularly through the sacrament of baptism, which, even though he was talking about confession yesterday, our confession is considered sort of our second baptism. It is what helps us to get back to where we're supposed to be, to get us back to sort of that baptismal purity once more. And I think that's really what we got from yesterday's talk, is that reminder of that and that call to live out our life more deeply, both in what we do and what we shouldn't be doing. So without further ado, I'd like to again introduce our speaker of tonight, Father Fred. Thank you for being with us.
My friends, let's begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, tonight, my friends, our topic is faith, hope, and love, the most powerful weapons of virtue that we have at our disposal. You and I, during the course of our spiritual lives, on our way home to heaven, contend with many difficulties, do we not? And what are some of the things that you and I contend with? We contend with the mistreatment of others. We live in a world that's ransacked with war, with violence, with destruction, with pandemics, with various forms of sickness, with various forms of suffering, and ultimately the one thing that many people are most afraid of, the inevitability of what? Death. These are all the things that you and I contend with as we journey home to heaven. Now, have any one of you ever heard of what's referred to as the prosperity gospel? Did you ever hear of that? The prosperity gospel? In other words, there are some people who believe, or there are some people, rather, I should say, that use religion as a means to perpetually escape suffering. In other words, if I remain faithful to God, if I adhere to his commandments, if I tithe and I give generously and I try to live a self-sacrificial life, nothing bad will ever happen to me. We laugh. You know why? Because we're Catholic Christians. But there are many people who believe that if I live this way, nothing bad will happen. Life will be a bunch of roses and wine, and I'll be forever happy. My family and I will be kept safe. Good luck. I can remember, and I aforementioned this last night, I was very fortunate to grow up in a wonderful Catholic family. Incidentally, I'm the only child. I'll explain why tomorrow night, but I'm not letting that line go yet, okay? But I was fortunate because I had an uncle who was a priest, my mother's brother, Father Ed. Father Ed and I were inseparable. I love my uncle the priest, and I have no doubt that my vocation is the fruit of my own uncle's prayers and his magnificent example that he set for me. Well, every Sunday, my uncle would come to our house for dinner. And he didn't just come to our house. He went to every one of my cousin's houses, too. My uncle was a big guy. He looked like Thomas Aquinas. He was huge. All right? So late in the afternoon, on a Sunday afternoon, my uncle, Father Ed, would come over, and I loved it. I loved listening to him. My father loved it. But my father would kind of tease my uncle. You see, my father loved, and I think it might still be on now, on Sunday afternoons, you ever hear the Gaithers? Protestants. Wonderful music. My father loves the music. My father used to tease my uncle all the time and say, the Protestants have better music than you Catholics do. Used to drive my uncle ballistic. He'd walk in the house, he'd hear the music, he'd run into the living room. Now, my uncle was an Irish Catholic priest. He had tremendous wit, tremendous intelligence, and a tremendous temper. He'd storm into the house and he'd say, shut that off. And my father would go, it's my house. You can't tell me to shut that off. He goes, shut it off. Get it off. I don't want to listen to it. And my father would change the channel. We'd watch something else for a few moments. And then my father, just to get his goat, would turn it right back on again. Only when he would turn it back on, now whoever the preacher was would be giving a sermon. And my father would say the best lines. He'd say, boy, can't they preach? And he'd say, Ed, don't you wish you could preach like him? And my uncle's face would turn like seven shades of red, huh? And my uncle would say something that I never forget. He'd say, are you listening to what he's saying? I mean, the sermons always sounded wonderful. Are you sick? If you're sick, you just have to pray. And if you're still sick, you're not praying enough. You just need to pray more. Are your finances all askew? Well, that's because you're not giving generously. You've got to give from what you don't have. Are you worried that you're not going to have any meals tomorrow? You have a little bit of money in the bank? Well, give it to us. And God will supply. And if you don't believe me, it means you don't trust. And my uncle would listen to this and he would get mad. My father would say, well, at least it sounds good. It doesn't sound good. He goes, listen to what they're saying. This prosperity gospel doesn't work. And it certainly isn't Catholic. My uncle, on Sunday, every single Sunday that my father would tease him, would always look at me intently in my eyes, and he would say, Freddie, being Catholic will never be easy. But it's true. Being Catholic will never be easy. But it's true. And we hold that near and dear to our hearts, don't we, my friends? We believe the Holy Roman Catholic and Apostolic Church to be the one true church. But if you're expecting to live in this life and to never have any manifestation of any trials or tribulations or any terrible things to happen, you're sadly mistaken. And if you don't believe me, read the Roman Martyrology. Read about the countless men and women who selflessly went to their deaths for the sake of God, the gospel, and for the sake of the church. It's not easy, but it is true. Do you remember, before our Lord, after his glorious resurrection, before his ascension, he led his friends through a very particular path. Did you know what the path was that he took them before he ascended to the right hand of the Father? He took them through the Garden of Gethsemane once again. Do you know why he took his friends, his closest companions, through the Garden of Gethsemane before he ascended to heaven? To show them that the pathway to eternal life is oftentimes paved with tremendous suffering. Now, I don't mean to discourage you good people tonight. I don't mean to make you melancholy and sad. I'm only telling you the truth, because the purpose of tonight's talk is this. What do we have at our disposal to combat those moments when things don't necessarily go right? Those moments when we're afraid, those moments when we're confronted with inevitable obstacles, those moments when sometimes we're tempted to just give up. We have a magnificent model. Her name is Mary. And I get mad sometimes. I get upset sometimes, especially when parishioners who lack understanding will say things, and they don't mean it, they say it in ignorance. Oh, it was easy for Mary. it was easy for Mary. And some people are under the false impression, well, you know, Father, she was immaculately conceived. Well, she still had free will. When the angel Gabriel appeared to her at the Annunciation, you know what Mary could have said? No. But she didn't. She acquiesced unreservedly to God's divine will. Can you imagine a young girl between the ages of 12 and 14, God entrusts the entire plan of salvation history on her shoulders. I wouldn't let a 12-year-old hold my shoes. But it teaches us something. Whenever you doubt, whenever you think that the world has gotten too bad, whenever you think that everything is about to end, there is no more good in the world, look at Mary. The fact that God would trust her with his plan of salvation proves something of paramount importance to all of us, my friends. It proves that God still believes in the possibility for human good. And Mary is that example. She's that shining example that God still believes in the possibility for human good. But life wasn't easy for Mary. You know, when I was in my deacon year in the seminary, I studied at Mount St. Mary's Seminary in Emmitsburg, Maryland. In my deacon year, I was assigned to a wonderful, wonderful parish. Incidentally, it was called Seven Sorrows of the Blessed Virgin Mother. And I loved that parish. I had a magnificent pastor. He was kind and he was generous and he was a wonderful, wonderful mentor to me. But I developed, during my time there, a particular devotion to the Seven Sorrows of the Blessed Virgin Mother. And can you imagine, even at the onset, at the prophecy of Simeon, you know, you have this beautiful bundle of joy in your arms, you bring him to the temple to present him, and all of a sudden you hear, this kid's going to be the rise and the fall of many. This kid of yours is going to be a sign of contradiction in the world. This son of yours is going to turn the entire world on its head. And you, my dear, your heart will be pierced with a sword. Imagine how she must have felt when she heard those words. What have I gotten myself into? Where is this going to lead? But even in that moment, Mary possessed those virtues. She had amazing faith. Not only did she have faith, but she had hope. And the best definition of hope is the expectation that what you believe in will come true. And no one encompassed a loving heart more than her immaculate one. Let's go to the next sorrow. I mentioned it last night. Did you ever lose your kid for 3 days? You know, the original Greek translation in the gospel says that Mary's bowels were twisted inside. That's the agony, and that's the pain that she felt. You know who I always felt bad for in that situation? Saint Joseph. You've got one who's immaculately conceived, the other who's lost as the Son of God. Whose fault do you think it was? I always felt bad for St. Joseph, huh? But even in that moment, you've lost not only your son, the Son of God, but there was faith, hope, and love. How about when he was condemned to die? The innocent, spotless lamb. Condemned to die with a massive crowd of people, not wishing for the release of the innocent, but for the release of a murderer and a robber and a plunderer and a thug. Imagine how she must have felt in that moment. You know, one of my favorite scenes during the Stations of the Cross on Fridays during Lent is when Mary encounters his mother. And how many of you have seen the wonderful movie, The Passion of the Christ? Remember that exchange? You know, it's cinema. Mel Gibson did a beautiful job in my estimation, but they look at each other intently. What does he say to her? I make all things new. Don't let your temporal eyes misguide you or deceive you. Everything you see will be made new again. How about the crucifixion? Can you imagine how she must have felt kneeling with Mary Magdalene and St. John at the foot of the cross, watching him in horror as he suffocated for 3 hours on the cross. What mother doesn't want to comfort her child? What mother doesn't want to relinquish all of his pain and his agony and his anxiety? What mother doesn't just want to be there? But in that moment, she was helpless. There was nothing she could do. Nothing but have faith. Nothing but have hope. And nothing but love God with every fiber of her being. You know, my favorite image, and matter of fact, I had it placed on my ordination card, is the Pietà. But I have a stark Pietà. It's a beautiful painting. It's dark. And it has Mary holding the lifeless body of her son in her arms. And as you look at the prayer card, she's staring intently at you, almost as if to say, look at what your sins cost my son. And don't ever forget what sin did to him. And then she places him in the tomb, knowing and believing that what God said would be fulfilled. She's our example. She's our model to follow. No one of us would argue that we have a harder life than she did. And so she becomes the model for us par excellence of what to do and where to go. Always look to Mary. What I'm going to do tonight, my friends, is this. I'm going to give you a series of stories that accentuate human suffering, but also encompass the particular virtues that you and I are going to discuss tonight. And I want you to know something, and I want you to understand this, and I want you to believe this. I said this last night during my homily, but it bears repeating, and I'm going to say it again. This is living and effective. And I said that last night. I said, if you want to grow closer in your relationship to Jesus Christ, read sacred scripture, study sacred scripture. And I said last night, you might not always comprehend it, you might not always understand it, it doesn't matter. And as St. Jerome said, ignorance of scripture is ignorance of Christ. Spend time with this season of Lent. I promise you, these sacred pages will speak to you because they're divinely inspired by Him. I'm going to propose something else to you tonight, something that I didn't propose to you last night. I would propose, because this is the living and effective Word of God, there are instances in this sacred text that all of us have encountered and experienced in our own individual lives. And if you don't believe me, allow me to prove it to you tonight. Okay? Keep that in mind. Not only have you heard these stories, not only have you hopefully read these stories, you and I have lived these stories. And I'm going to give you some homework tonight. Okay? Oh no, the priest has given us homework. Should have stayed home tonight. Do yourself a favor. Think about what I'm about to say tonight. Then pick up sacred scripture and read it. And try to find a time in your life where you not only read it, but you experienced it and lived it. We're going to begin with the virtue of faith. Now, one of my favorite people in the church, I mentioned him last night, was the son of St. Monica, Augustine. And I think St. Augustine has a great definition of faith. Of faith, St. Augustine said the following. Faith is believing what you cannot see. But the reward of faith is one day seeing what you've always believed to be true. Now, I want you good pupils to learn that, so I want you to repeat it with me. Faith is believing what you cannot see. But the reward of faith is one day seeing what you believe. It makes sense, doesn't it? Now, see, now you can go out into the world and evangelize. They'll come up to you and they'll say, what is faith? Faith is believing what you cannot see, but the reward of faith is one day seeing what you've always believed to be true. Listen to this, my friends. This is a story about faith. Then Jesus went from that place and withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman of that district came and called out, have pity on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon. But he did not say a word in answer to her. His disciples came and asked him, "Send her away, for she keeps calling out after us." He said in reply, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But the woman came and did him homage, saying, "Lord, help me." He said in reply, "It is not right to take the food of the children and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Please, Lord, for even the dogs eat the scraps that fall from the table of their masters." Then Jesus said to her in reply, "O woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed from that hour. I've met the Canaanite woman. "O woman, how great is your faith." I'm going to share a story with you now that I affectionately refer to, and I've entitled, "Priest Before Police." You get that? Priest before police. You'll understand what I mean in a moment. My very first assignment was in the town of Athol, Massachusetts. Does anyone know where Athol is? He lives right next door, huh? What's he live in, Royalston or Orange? Orange, yeah. Well, for anybody who doesn't know where Athol is, it's on the Canadian border. And when I was a young man in the seminary, you know, we get all excited before we're ordained, and there was a rumor going around the seminary, not like the rumors I told you about last night, but there was a rumor going on in the seminary that you could tell how much the bishop held you in esteem by how close he assigned you to himself. I went to Athol. So, you know what? It was a beautiful, beautiful assignment. You know, the people of Athol were impoverished. There was drugs and there was domestic violence and there was a history of problems. But you know what? For the most part, the people, as impoverished as they were the most generous people I've ever encountered in my life. And it was one of my favorite assignments. As a priest, you always say your first assignment is like your first love. And I was only there for about a year and a half. While I was there, my pastor at the time became very, very sick. And subsequently, I was alone for 3 months. I was a newly ordained priest alone in a cluster parish for 3 months. We had Our Lady Immaculate in Athol, we had St. Francis in Athol, we had St. Peter's in Petersham, and we had Our Lady Queen of Heaven in Royalston. And guess who got to go around to all of them? You talk about trial by fire, huh? When I was in the seminary, I'll never forget a professor made the following statement, and this didn't come as a surprise to me, maybe to some of my classmates, but to me this was no shock. The statement that was made to us was, "Gentlemen, when you become priests in parishes, you will inevitably encounter parishioners who are holier than you." That didn't shock me. I know myself far too well. I'm going to meet somebody who's better than me, no big surprise there, okay? And in my first assignment, I encountered one such woman. She was a wonderful woman. She was of Saudi Arabian descent. Okay, she came from Saudi Arabia. She had Catholic faith like I had never seen before. Came to daily Mass. Not only did she come to daily Mass, she would spend between 2 and 3 hours in front of the Blessed Sacrament every day after Mass. This woman was holy. And the other thing I remember about her, she chain-smoked like crazy. Even if I would walk into the church, I could tell she was in the church without even seeing her because I could smell the stale cigarettes on her, huh? But she was a magnificent, magnificent woman. One day after Mass, I celebrated Mass in the morning, I went back to the rectory, and I was sitting in my office. It was probably an hour after Mass. All of a sudden, the phone rings. I answer the phone, and I can hear her on the other line. "Father, Father, you come now, you come now." "I come where?" "You come my house now, you come bless my house now. Must bless house, must bless house." I said, I don't know where you live. I give you address, you come right now." I said, "I'll come right now." "Okay, calm down, I'm coming." So I get ready, I grab some holy water, I grab the book of blessings, and I leave the rectory. I meet her where she is. Now, she owned a three-decker in Athol. She was a landlord. She goes, you come bless my apartment right now, you come bless." Absolutely. And she is frantic. She's shaking. She's smoking like crazy. And we go into the three-decker. Now, I get into this apartment. Now, instantaneously, there's something wrong. I'm in this apartment, and there's pictures of the Grateful Dead everywhere. Bob Marley. All of these classical music bands, and I mean, this looks like a deadhead apartment. And so I stopped, and I said, is this your apartment? Oh, no, 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 this my tenant, but we must bless. Well, time out, does your tenant know we're in his apartment right now? We can't just go into people's apartments and, no, Father, no, Father, he won't mind, he won't. We must bless, Father, we must bless. And so I said, oh, well, okay, I guess so, but let's do this quick before he comes home. So I begin to write a blessing, and I'm blessing. And we get to his bedroom. And she said, Father, now you must really pray. You never get that feeling where you know in that moment something is seriously, seriously wrong. And when I went into the bedroom, I saw something that no one should ever see in their life. That poor young man, her tenant, he committed suicide, and he was hanging in the closet. I stopped and I said to her, we need to leave here right now. I said, this is a crime scene. We shouldn't be in here. You should have called the police. No, 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 Father, we need prayers. Father, we need prayers. The evil one, he has been here, the evil one. Look what happened, Father. Look, we need prayers. We need blessings. We don't need police. I said, no, we need the police. I said, let's get out of here. And at the time, I was the chaplain for the Athol Police Department, so I took her outside, and I immediately called the police. Now, when my friends who were on the Athol Police Department came, they couldn't believe it. They said, she called a priest before she called us? After witnessing something like, this lady's crazy. But it's funny, isn't it? Some of the greatest of the lives of the saints were called what? Crazy. John the Baptist was called crazy. St. Francis, crazy. And the list goes on and on and on and on. But then she did something that I'll never forget. The police were there and they were securing the area. And I was getting ready to leave. And she saw me making my way to my car and she started screaming, Father, Father, Father. I said, what, what? She's holding something in the air. It was a check. She handed me a check for $1,000. And I said, why are you giving me a check for $1,000? She said, Father, I want 100 masses said for his soul. Because the evil one was here. His soul is in jeopardy. And I want to pray him to heaven. That's tragedy. But that's tragedy that encompasses a tremendous, tremendous amount of faith. And in that moment, until this day, I can see it vividly, those words of our Lord came to me. Oh, woman, how great is your faith? That's one way to contend with evil and tragedy in the midst of the world, with the eyes of faith. Not, my friends, with temporal eyes that just focus on the here and now, but with eyes that perpetually focus towards the eternal. Let's go to the second virtue tonight, hope. And as I aforementioned, hope is the desire for something, but not only the desire for something, the expectation that you and I will receive it. The next story that I'd like to share with you is entitled, A Gift Without the Giver is Bare. A gift without the giver is bare. My second assignment, I was in the city of Gardner. Anybody know where Gardner is? Look at you archdiocesan people knowing all about the Worcester Diocese. I'm impressed. We affectionately call Gardner G. Vegas. G. Vegas. I'll tell you a funny story real quick about that. Kind of off subject, but that's okay, because you know me. I get distracted. My first assignment was Athol. Second assignment's Gardner. And I loved being in Gardner. When I was a young seminarian, I had prayed that I would go to a parish with a school. I wanted to get involved with the schools. Incidentally, my last assignment, I was a headmaster of a Catholic school for 6 years. I don't pray for that anymore. So in Gardner, I had 3 years with two different Catholic elementary schools. I was the associate. We had Sacred Heart School. We had Holy Rosary School. Then I became the headmaster and the pastor of St. Anna's Parish in Leominster. I was the pastor and the headmaster, and that's it. I'm done. Matter of fact, Bishop McManus came up to me the other day, and he goes, would you have any interest in, don't tell him I mimicked his voice either, I'll get in trouble. Probably send me to a school again. He goes, would you have any interest in parochial schools? I said, no, I did my time, thank you. Actually, I didn't say that. I said, I would reluctantly, under obedience, do whatever you tell me to do. But please leave me alone. But anyway, I wanted to ingratiate myself with the people of Gardner. Now, every Thursday night in Gardner, they had a wonderful, wonderful devotion. A wonderful devotion. You might think it was the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass. Perhaps it was a rosary, maybe Divine Mercy. No, it was called bingo. Okay? And this was a devotion that got more attendance than Mass, sadly, huh? But I said, if the people of Gardner love bingo so much, and I'm the brand new guy on the block, maybe I'll go to the bingo hall and I'll introduce myself, huh? So I'm in there, and I'm greeting people, and all the ladies are smiling at me. You know, there's a cute young priest. Hi, Father. You know, all of a sudden, there's a lady in the very back of the bingo hall in a wheelchair, and she stands up. She's in a wheelchair. She stands up, and I'm thinking, wow, this is powerful. And she starts yelling, Father, come here. You know, the raspy smoker's voice, come here. So I go over to her. And she goes, I want you to do me a favor. Now, you're the young guy. You're the new kid on the block. You want to acquiesce. You want everybody to like you, huh? So I said, sure, name it. Don't ever say that when somebody asks you for a favor without knowing what they're asking for, okay? So I said, sure, name it. What do you want me to do? She goes, I want you to bless my bingo cards. Now I'm in it, huh? Sure, whatever you want, huh? So there I am, and I'm thinking to myself, okay, I've blessed people, I've blessed rosary beads, I've blessed medals, I've blessed homes, I've blessed automobiles, motorcycles, I've blessed everything under the sun. Never in my life have I blessed a bingo card. Now I'm bordering around like sacrilege, huh? But I opened my big fat mouth. So I said to her, listen, I'll bless your bingo cards under one condition. She said, what's that? I said, you win, the money comes back to the church. She said, forget it. That was the last time I've ever been asked to bless a bingo card, huh? But anyway, that was just an aside to make you laugh. Incidentally, laughter is very important. Always laugh. Laughter is synonymous with the virtue of what? What we're talking about, hope. You and I, by virtue of our faith in Jesus Christ, are a people who can laugh even in the face of death. Why? Because we believe death no longer has power over us. We believe in the one who is love, who came to the world to once and for all vanquish final suffering, sickness, and death. But he came to vanquish what? Final suffering, sickness, and death. And when we say final, what do we mean? Not in the here and now, but in the life that is to come. Remember that. Doesn't mean you're going to be free and easy in this world, but you will be. In the world that is to come. That's what we mean by final. Anyway, I'm in Gardner. It's wonderful. And I developed a relationship with somebody that I loved so much. She was my secretary, Lisa. Lisa Blake loved Lisa. Lisa and I were like two peas in a pod. She had three daughters, wonderful daughters. She had a magnificent husband. But Lisa and I, every morning, would have coffee together in the office. She would bring me coffee, and we would talk. And we would talk about the day, we would talk about what's going on in the school, we would talk about the pastor. I'm just kidding, I never did that. We would talk about everything. Sometimes Lisa would be funny, and she would put Bailey's in my coffee in the morning. And I would drink it, and I'd say, this tastes funny. Oh, no, it's just, I don't know, they did something at Dunkin' Donuts. Yeah, they did something at Dunkin' Donuts, yeah. And I'll be crocked by 9 o'clock. Thank you very much, Lisa. So I used to tell her, stop being nice, Lisa, don't do that. But anyway, Lisa and I, you know, I loved her family. I loved listening to her stories. She was, you know, and priests will tell you that the people that you collaborate and you work with in the parish, they become like your family because you go through, you know, thick and thin with them. One afternoon, it was December 19th, 2010. I'll never forget it. I was invited by the musicians of the parish to go to a Christmas party. Did you ever have a long day? You know, you have a lot on the horizon, you have a long day, and you don't feel like going anywhere. Well, that's how I felt. I didn't want to go to the Christmas party. My mind wasn't even Christmas yet. And I'm being kind of pessimistic. This is dumb. Who has Christmas parties before Christmas? Well, everybody, usually. But I was just feeling sorry for myself, didn't want to go, didn't care about it. Then the pastor called, and when the pastor calls you and tells you, you're going to the Christmas party, you really don't have a choice, huh? That's why it's great to be a pastor now. I don't have to do anything I don't want to do. No, I'm kidding. So I'm getting ready to go to the Christmas party, and all of a sudden I hear sirens. And when I say sirens, I mean sirens. It sounds like the city of Gardner is falling apart. There's fire truck after fire truck, ambulance after ambulance, police car after police car. And I'm thinking to myself, what in the world is going on in Gardner right now? And that went on for about an hour. And then it's kind of subsided, and you just say a little prayer. That's what I was always taught when I was a kid. You know, you say a little prayer for whoever's in trouble. And I made my way over to the Christmas party that I didn't want to go to. Now, when I got there, I was even more upset. There was nobody there but the two people who were hosting it. And so I go and I sit down, and I'm kind of uncomfortable. I had a senior priest who I lived with, Father Gerald Doré, and the pastor, and I don't know where they are. Now I'm really getting hot. They come to this dumb thing, and they're not even going to come. Would they make me come so they didn't look bad? I mean, what? What's going on here? All of a sudden, the phone rings. It's my pastor. And I'll never forget, the lady who was hosting the party, she said, Father Brian, who was my pastor, he's nothing like your Father Brian, though. Your Father Brian's a good guy. I'm teasing you. So he said, Father Brian wants to talk to you. And so I picked up the phone. He said, Fred, can you come to Lisa Blake's house right away? And I said, sure I can. What's wrong? He said, she was killed tonight. And I said, I'll be right there. And I hung up the phone and I said to the couple, I said, I have to go. Something has happened. Turns out what happened, my friends, was my secretary, Lisa, she loved to walk. She walked all over the place, all over Gardner. She was a health nut. And she was walking on that afternoon of December 19th, and there was a young man who was in high school with her daughter in the same class who was working at Mount Wachusett as a ski instructor. The young man had gone home sick because he wasn't feeling well. During the course of driving back to his home in Gardner, he became sick behind the wheel, went off the road, and ran over my secretary. She was killed. I'll never forget pulling up to the house on that evening. You know what it's like in December. It's, you know, think about the cold weather we've had the last few weeks, huh? All the houses are buttoned up. If you go outside, it's almost deafening, the silence. I pulled into the driveway, and as soon as I got out of my car, I could hear the screams of her daughters coming from inside the house. And in that moment, I just thought, my God, why? It's December 19th, it's days before Christmas. She's got three beautiful young daughters, all in high school. Why did this happen? She's got a wonderful husband who now has to raise these girls on his own. Why in the world did this happen? And I went into the house, and her husband just grabbed me and he hugged me, and he said something that made me feel good in that moment. He said, you don't know how much she loved you. He said, she loved you more than anything. He said, would you please celebrate her funeral mass? And I said, I'll do whatever you want me to do, David. Whatever you need, I'm so sorry. And we just cried together. Now in that moment, even for a priest, you talk about a spiritual hurdle. There's a hurdle there. That's my friend. This is my friend who worked for you. She worked for you. She worked for the church. She did so many wonderful things for the children in the school. She was a wonderful, wonderful woman. Why did this happen? How could this happen? And I was lost, and I was angry, and I was frustrated, and I was confounded. I had every negative human emotion that you could possibly possess. And I was a priest. But even in that moment, I struggled. I struggled in a way that I never struggled before. Incidentally, December 20th, you know what that is? My mother's birthday. And guess who had to take her to Chuck's Steakhouse in Auburn that night? The day after Lisa died. And my poor mother, she begged me, we don't have to go. I know how upset you are. Please, we can stay home. I said, no, Mom, it's your birthday. We're going to go. I didn't eat a bite. And I just stared off into space. And I felt so bad because my heart was broken, but at the same time, I felt bad for my mother because I was seemingly ruining her birthday. And then the announcement comes of when Lisa's funeral will be. December 24th, Christmas Eve. On the night of the 23rd, I went over and I did the vigil prayers across the street at Boucher Funeral Home. And I've got to be honest with you, I'm celebrating her funeral mass on Christmas Eve. My laptop computer was empty. It was a blank screen. I couldn't write a single word. I couldn't think. I had no idea what in the world I was going to say. How in the world am I going to bring solace and comfort to these people when I can't even find solace and comfort in my own life, when I'm angry and bitter and resentful and I'm questioning everything? About 9:30 that evening, after the wake was wrapping up, my friend, God rest his soul, he's since died, he was the owner of the funeral home, Andrew Boucher, he called me, and he said to me, "Hey, bud, they got a request." And I said, "Sure. What's the request? Anything they want." He said, "Well, you know, you saw Lisa's casket. It's a beautiful white casket." I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, her daughters want to know if it would be okay with you if they could adorn her casket with a beautiful red bow tomorrow." So I said to my friend Andrew, I said, "Well, why do they want to put a big red bow on her casket?" And he said to me, "Well, the girls came up with the idea that their mother was the greatest gift that they could have ever received. And since tomorrow we'll celebrate God's birthday, they want to give the greatest gift they've ever received back to Him." Talk about hope. That was 9:30 at night he called me and told me that. Something beautiful happened. The fingers started working. The mind started working. The heart was being spoken to. He did all the work. In a moment of tragedy, in a moment of destruction, in a moment of grief, he did all the work, and it made perfect sense, which is why I entitled it that way. A gift without the giver is bare. Made perfect sense for Christmas. What was the reason that he came into the world? For you and me. Because had he not come into the world, you and I could have never been afforded the promise of eternal life. We're all going to die. But thanks be to God, because of his gift, we don't die forever. But we live eternally. There's another story that encompasses both aspects, both faith and hope, two virtues. And I want to share that story with you now. Do you remember when Officer Ronald Tarantino was viciously gunned down and killed in the town of Auburn? Do you remember that? Well, I was serving at the time as one of the 6 Massachusetts State Police chaplains. And incidentally, they only call the police chaplains when something horrible happens. So I had just celebrated my first Sunday morning mass at St. Anna's in Leominster, and the state police called me, and they said, "Father, one of the Auburn police officers was shot and killed last night, and we need you, if you can, to immediately go to Leicester to be with his family." And I said, "Absolutely." So I called my secretary. I said, "We have to do everything in our power to try to get coverage right now. I have to try to get down to Leicester." So that was no problem. We got coverage, and I made my way down to Leicester. Now, they told me, they said, "Go, just report to the Leicester Police Department." Okay. So I go to the Leicester Police Department. The chief of police is there. I'm dressed just as I am before you right now. And I said, "Hi, I'm Father Franey. I'm one of the Massachusetts State Police chaplains. I've been sent to go to the Tarantino house." He looked at me. He said, "Are you sure you're a priest?" I said, "Yeah, I'm pretty sure." "Do you have any credentials?" "Well, thanks be to God, the state police gave me a badge and an ID card." He wanted both of them. And I said to him, I said, "Chief, this is a little crazy, isn't it?" He goes, "No, and this is the kind of world we live in. You know, there are clowns that will dress up like this just so they can get close to the family in moments like that. Sick, isn't it?" But nevertheless, my credentials passed, and he brought me to the Tarantino house. I'll never forget the first time I met Trish, his wife. open the door. Now, this is a woman who has just lost her husband. He's been viciously murdered. And her sons are there. This woman opens the door, greets me, gives me the biggest hug, and goes, "Thank you so much for coming. Can I get you anything? Can you get me anything?" That was the first inclination. She was vastly different than anybody I'd ever met in my life. In a moment when she needs someone the most, she's going out of her way to see if I need anything. I said, no. I said, "I'm here for you, not the other way around." And I made my way into the house, and we started to talk. I remember talking to his boys and explaining to them what a hero their father was and how sorry I was and how the next few days were going to be complicated and there was going to be a lot of attention and that we would be there for whatever they needed whenever they needed it. And then I heard something. I heard their mom, Trish, in the living room, and I could see her. She was pacing back and forth, and she was having a wonderful conversation. I know, thank you so much. No, I know you're with me. I know you love me. I know everything's going to be okay. I know we're going to get through this. Oh, it's just so hard to believe. I can't believe this happened. This is one of your worst nightmares, and she's going back and forth, just pacing. So I said to the boys, I said, "Who's your mom talking to?" I said, "Who's she on the phone with?" They looked at me and they said, "Father, she's not on the phone." I said, "She's not. So who's she talking to?" "She's talking to God, Father. She's talking to God." That woman talked to God like she was talking to her closest relative. If I didn't know better, I would have thought she was on the phone with her father, I swear. Being reassured. Even in that darkest moment, having the faith to know that everything will be okay, hoping against all hope. It was amazing. I don't know, man, how many of you remember that, but in all the interactions I had with the state police, everyone agrees that we've never seen anyone stronger than that woman. The way she composed herself, the way that she dealt with the situation, and the optimism that she possessed despite the devastating tragedy that had occurred. That's what faith does. You know, as a priest, it breaks my heart so often, and I'm sure it breaks the hearts of all priests. I don't know how people live in this world without the gift of faith. It's got to be a horrible, lonely existence. It's got to seem extremely isolating without the conviction and the belief of something else. If this is all there is, my friends, God help us, but thanks be to God, it's not. Thanks be to God, there is so much more. You'll remember that the Massachusetts State Police stop team apprehended the man who was responsible for shooting Officer Ronald Tarantino. And that man, that suspect, was killed in that interaction. And one of the Massachusetts State Police officers was shot in that interaction. His name was A.J. Carduz, is A.J. Carduz. One of the things to kind of lighten this story is I was in the command center at the Auburn Police watching everything transpire when they were trying to apprehend Jorge Zambrano. And immediately we heard that there was an officer shot. He's laying on a stretcher. He's bleeding profusely from his shoulder where he's been shot. "I need a comb, Father. Give me a comb." And his hair's all messed up because he had his helmet on. I said, "What do you need a comb for?" He goes, "Do you know how many cute nurses might be in there?" Keep laughing. You got to laugh. True story. I didn't tell his girlfriend he said that, though. Hope she's not watching. That brings us, my friends, to the third virtue, the virtue of love. Again, We go back to sacred scripture. In a time where we've lived and experienced this particular virtue. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way. Thomas said to him, Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The two greatest gifts that you and I can receive in this life are love and life. Would you agree? But love is a misused and confused term in contemporary society, is it not? Don't we use the term love synonymously with so many different things? Take you wonderful ladies here present tonight. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I've heard this to be true. I'm told that some of you love shoes. I don't know about any of you, but I don't want to be loved like a pair of shoes, especially the ones that I'm wearing. I don't take particularly good care of them. I love this in life. I love that in life. As faithful Catholic Christians journeying spiritually towards the kingdom of heaven, journeying during this holy season of Lent, we have to recognize love as something more. Love is more than a word. It's more than an emotion. It's more than a gesture. It's more than an expression. It's more than a thought or a feeling. As Catholic Christians during the holy season of Lent, we recognize love to be nothing else but a person. A trinity of persons. Love is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That's the first gift, love. The second gift is life. God is the author of all life, both human and divine. Now, never in my life have I heard these two gifts of love and life more eloquently or poetically expressed than in the words of G.K. Chesterton in what he entitled his great proposal. Now, that great author said the following. He said, there are four great lamps of thanksgiving burning before me. The first is that I was born out of the same earth as you. Second, I have tried to love everything in the universe as a remote preparation for loving you. Third, I have never run after strange things. You cannot understand how much this prepares someone for true love. And fourth, my life ends here. It has led me back to you. Now tonight, my friends, I want you to understand Chesterton's words to mean this, that our lives here on earth merely prepare us for the greatest love affair we can imagine, the everlasting reunion of our souls with Christ in paradise, that no one of us will experience the happiness we're created for in this life, but instead only the life that is to come. And you have to know that. You and I will never be as happy as we're created to be in this life. It's impossible. Augustine said it. Our souls will not rest until what? They rest in you, O God. There's always going to be something inside of us that pines for more. There's always going to be something inside of us that can only be satiated by the love of God. And nothing will fill that void but Him and His love. So it's up to us. If we want to get home to the kingdom of heaven, we have to do our best to live an extraordinary life of perfect love. Now, I've just explained to you who love is, but you good Catholic Christians already knew who love was. But do you know what love requires? Three things. Freedom. Love requires freedom. You and I can't love any one person or thing in this world without being completely free to do so. Let me pick on a couple. There's one. How long have you wonderful people been married? Oh, you're not? Well, that didn't work. I can arrange it if you want. Give me a married couple, quick.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. It embarrassed me. Which ones? How long have you guys been married for? You're not sure. When do I start the annulment? No, I'm just kidding. 29 years? 34 years. So where were you guys married? Where were you married? St. Rita's in Lowell. Okay. Did you propose to her? That's the standard. Would you ask her parents' permission first?
No.
Aren't they supposed to do that? Are they supposed to get the blessing? No, I'm just kidding. Let me ask you something. On the day that you were married, did he tie you up in chains and drag you into the church? No. Why? Because if he had done that, you wouldn't have been in love with him. You would have been in force with him. One of my favorite things to do is to marry young couples. I love it. I love it. I even love more preparing them for marriage. Because I'm a real jerk when I do that. I ask them kinds of questions. I said, do you love her? Oh, I love her. Uh-huh. Will you ever cheat on her? Now, the girls are much better at that. No, I would never do that. The guy, I'm not married. But then I'll ask him another question. Why would you never be unfaithful? Why would you never fall into infidelity? Because it's a rule? Well, no, of course not, because I love her. I would never want to hurt her. I would never want to hurt him. Good answer. But anyway, we get to the wedding day after they go through the brutality of my wedding prep, huh? My marriage prep. So here they are, and I always feel bad for you people at weddings, huh? Because usually the way I set it up is the couple is facing me. You know, I have chairs here, but their backs are facing you, so you miss the whole show. You really do. You miss the show. It's the funniest thing, because I sit in the big presider's chair, you know, mine's over there, but Father Brian's is over here, and you can watch them. And they're so cute on their wedding day. They hold each other's hands. And they look intently at each other's eyes. And sometimes they even talk to each other. Do you want to know what they say? I love you. No, I love you. No, I love you. I love you. And I do this. I sit up here, and I watch all of this, right? And I'm sitting there, and I'm a rather cynical human being. You could tell that now, right? And I watch this, and I love you, I love you, I love you. And every time I hear the word love, one word goes into my mind. Do you want to know what it is? Wait. Now you laugh. You laugh because you know I'm right, because I don't want them to be naive or amiss. Love isn't a choice that you make once and simply hope will last forever. It's a perpetual, everlasting, unconditional choice. People ask me sometimes, Father, when did you decide to become a priest? You know what I tell them? When I woke up this morning. It's true. Because I can't think that on June 7th, 2008, when I kneeled, lay prostrate on the floor of St. Paul's Cathedral in Worcester, that was the only time I was going to decide to be a priest. No. You have to recommit yourself each and every single day. You have to make the choice in freedom. There's a second component of love besides freedom, and that's sacrifice. Love without sacrifice is nothing more than selfishness. Once I've chosen in perfect freedom to love any one person or thing in this world, I have to be willing to sacrifice for that which I love. You know what that means? It means giving without counting the cost. It means giving, expecting nothing in return. It means giving to the point of your own detriment and demise. It means going without a thank you, but giving anyway. It means placing yourself second so that the one that you love can always be first. There's a third and final component of love, and that's mystery. You and I will never love what we think we've got completely figured out. Do you find religion confusing sometimes? Do you find God perplexing sometimes? Do you find God hard to figure out? You're supposed to. And you have an eternity, God please, in heaven. And you know what? You won't figure him out. You'll never figure him out. He'll always be mysterious. And you know why? Because that's what love requires. As a priest, one of my favorite things to do is I love to visit couples who are homebound, who can't get out for Mass, and I bring them communion, huh? And there was this one couple in my parish, I love them, they live in a trailer park off of Route 20 in Auburn, And every time I go to their house, they're on the couch in the little living room of the trailer, and they look like they're part of the couch. I don't think they ever leave it. Like, seriously, you could almost sit on them. You wouldn't know they were there in the couch. And so I walk in, and I do the same thing every time I go to their house. I have to shut off the television, you know, and there they are, the two heads. Hi, Father, you know. And they've been married and in love for like 63 years. They're the cutest couple in the world. And so one day I said to him, I said, you guys have been married for 63 years? Uh-huh. And I said, what's the secret? And the husband says, what do you want to know the secret for? I said, because I want to write a book and make a lot of money. And he goes, I'll tell you the secret. And he's holding her hand, and they look so cute. He goes, you see this beautiful bride? I said, uh-huh. He goes, every day of my life, he goes, she says something that I never expect her to say. And every day of my life, she does something that I never expect her to do. And because of that, every day I fall deeper and deeper in love with her. They're mysterious to one another. There has to be something that continuously captivates your attention and draws you deeper in. And I tell young couples that all the time, be spontaneous. Go out of your way to display random acts of kindness and affection that the other one would never expect. And if you do that, you'll incorporate mystery into your love, and that mystery and that love will endure for eternity. You're probably wondering how I know so much about love, huh? After all, I'm articulate, intelligent, extremely humble, obviously, right? But there's no secret. How do I know love requires freedom, sacrifice, and mystery? Well, what are we celebrating during this holy season of Lent? The fact that over 2,000 years ago on the cross of Calvary, our blessed Lord Jesus Christ, in perfect freedom, chose to die so that we could live forever. On that cross, he sacrificed the one most precious gift the world has ever and will ever receive in his own body and blood for the redemption of the world. And as you gaze upon that perfect symbol of love in our midst, the mystery of God's inexpressible, inexhaustible love for you and I is so mysterious that even in heaven, God, please, we all get there one day. I promise you we'll stare upon his beautiful face and we'll question this. How is it possible that you love us this much? That's the virtue of love. And now I'm going to tell you a story about love. I call this story Father Ed Made Thursdays Holy. Kind of a pun on Holy Thursday. It's Lent. I got creative. Father Ed Made Thursdays Holy. I've told you this already, but I had a wonderful uncle who was a priest, and I was very fortunate to have my uncle who was a priest. My uncle did many wonderful things for me. My parents, after building their home in Auburn, Massachusetts, had very little money. They had a new baby, and my uncle was going to make absolute sure that that kid went to Catholic school. And who paid for the Catholic school? Not my parents. My uncle did. My uncle did many wonderful things for me. My uncle's priest friends used to joke with me because they said, Freddie, we think he loves you more than us. And the reason being is because my uncle would have typically Thursday afternoon and Friday off. Took the regular time that priests usually take off, about a day and a half. But Thursday's afternoons, he couldn't go out with his friends. You know why? Thursday afternoons were exclusively mine. Every Thursday afternoon when I got out of school, my uncle would pick me up, no matter where I was. And I'll never forget it. My uncle, I don't know what it was at the time, every priest had a Buick. You remember those times? If you were a Roman Catholic priest, you drove a Buick. And my uncle had a big, beautiful Buick LeSabre. And my uncle was a wonderful guy. You know, when he was on his day off, he would still wear the black pants, but he would have like a white t-shirt. And I told you, my uncle was a big guy. And he used to have this huge miraculous metal chain that he would wear. And the collared shirt would be off. His cleric shirt would be off. He'd have the white t-shirt on. He'd have the black pants. And he'd have holes in the t-shirt. It was embarrassing. But every Thursday, he would pick me up. And when I was little, I loved it. We did the same thing every Thursday. We went to my favorite place in the entire world, my favorite restaurant, McDonald's. Now, as a kid, a young kid, just got out of school, what would my uncle buy me at McDonald's? A 20-piece chicken McNugget, a large French fry and a large orange soda. And I would eat that every Thursday till I got sick. And my uncle would always make me say the same, he would always make me make the same promise. He'd say, "You're not going to tell anybody I did this, are you?" "No, Father Ed, no, I'm not going to do that." And we did that every Thursday together. And as a young boy, I would ask him questions about the faith. I'd ask him questions about God. And we loved each other's company. And I loved my uncle. What happens when you get a little bit older? You get a little bit older, you've heard the expression, you get too big for your britches. Well, I loved hanging out with my uncle when I was in elementary school. Then I got to middle school. And I loved hanging out with my uncle when I was in sixth grade. But now I was in seventh grade. And now I'm meeting friends. And now I'm getting interested in sports. And now I'm starting to establish friendships of my own. Do you remember one particular Thursday? I was in school, and I was invited by a group of boys to go play baseball after school, knowing full well that when that final bell rang, guess who was going to be in that parking lot waiting for me? The bell rang, and I walked outside with my new friends. And there was my uncle in that beautiful Buick LeSabre, waving out the window, "Freddy, Freddy," beeping the horn. My new friend said, "Who's that guy?" "I don't know, I've never seen him before in my life." My uncle saw me walking away, he started to beep the horn more incessantly. He's screaming, "Freddy, Freddy!" My new friends are saying, "You don't know him, he knows your name." "I don't know how he knows my name." And I kept walking. And I walked away from him. In seventh grade, I pretended that a man who loved me more than I deserved didn't exist. Just walked away from him. I went to the ball field, and I had fun with my new friends. When I got home, and I mentioned last night that I was a latchkey kid, and incidentally, that's why my uncle was so good to me, because he didn't want me to be alone. Felt bad that my parents had to work, and he wanted me to have companionship. But I had gotten to an age where I didn't need him anymore. I was on my own now. I got home later that afternoon from playing ball after having completely ignored someone who would never ignore me. And there was something in front of my garage. It was a bag. Inside the bag were 20 chicken McNuggets. There was a large French fry. And right outside was a large orange soda. And there was a note. And the note said the following. It said, "Freddie, I'm sorry I missed you today, but I thought maybe when you came home you might be hungry. So I bought this for you. Love, Father Ed." I didn't eat a bite of that meal. I sat in front of that garage and I cried like a baby. I thought, "You despicable person." But I couldn't understand it. And I think what made me so upset was, how in the world, why in the world would he have done that? I didn't deserve that. Why would he still go out of his way to give me something that he knew I loved when I had treated him so horribly? And it ate me up. And it ate me up so bad, my friends, that the very next time I saw him, I had to ask him. I said, "Father Ed, why did you do that?" And he said, "What are you upset about?" I said, "I didn't deserve that. I ignored you. You saw me ignore you. I denied you." And in that moment, even at a young age, you remember the gospel where after Peter's betrayal, it said he cried so much there were furrows in his cheeks. I know what that feels like. And I said, "Father Ed, why did you do that for me?" And he said, "Freddie, I love you." He said, "I'll always love you. There's nothing you could ever do to stop me from loving you." Then he said this, "I love you the way that God loves you." Talk about mercy. That's mercy. Receiving a gift that you know full well you don't deserve. That's why last night was so important. That's the sacrament of reconciliation, to receive a gift that you know full well you don't deserve. And when we deny ourselves that gift, what do? We look at the cross of Calvary and we say, yeah, thank you for everything you did for me, but I'm going to try to do it on my own. It's impossible. It'll never happen. I want to talk about one last thing tonight. I've given you examples tonight, I hope, my friends, of some tragedies and how the virtue of faith can help you, how the virtue of hope can help you. And now I want to help you understand a little bit more about love. Because I think one of the things that you and I will contend with, aside from tragedies and trials and tribulations that inevitably manifest themselves in our life, you and I most of the time are going to experience mistreatment, aren't we? People are going to do things to us that just aren't nice. And you and I, because of our human nature and concupiscence, are going to want to get even. And you and I are going to struggle, and perhaps one of the greatest things that we struggle with is what? Forgiveness. We don't like to forgive. And so now I'm going to share with you a story about forgiveness. I call this one Auntie Katie and the Cousins. When I was a young boy growing up, I had an uncle who was very close to me. His name was Ray. And Ray fostered my love of the outdoors. He was my mother's sister's husband. And he taught me how to fish. He took me to baseball games. He took me to Celtics games. My father wasn't a big sports guy. He is now. I don't know where he came from. But now my father loves sports. My father loves golf. He loves to watch golf. I like to play golf. I'd rather play it than watch it. But, you know, my dad, when I was growing up, he worked. I mean, my dad was a police officer. He worked many hard hours. He was in the United States military. He was in the Air Force. He went on various deployments. My dad really did everything in his power to try to make sure that my mom and I were provided for. And so I didn't begrudge him that. He was a great dad. He still is. But my uncle, who was, you know, always around, would take me places and take me fishing. Well, my uncle passed away. My uncle sadly died when I was in college of lung cancer. And, you know, I became particularly close, and always was, to my Aunt Katie. She was kind of like a second mother to me growing up, because my mother would always drop me off over there, and they had a swimming pool in the summer, so I always had a lot of fun with my Aunt Katie and my Uncle Ray. My Aunt Katie, later on in life, developed dementia. And I can remember I was at my second assignment in Gardner, and my aunt was really failing, so much to the extent that she was leaving the house because she lived alone, obviously, because my uncle had passed, and her children lived in Boston. My aunt would leave the house and she would wander the neighborhood. Well, the neighbors got nervous, so they called my mother, they called her other sister, and they said, something's gonna happen. We're worried something's gonna happen to her. You know, we look out the window at 11 o'clock at night and she's walking up and down the street. Now, my mother, God rest her soul, God love her, she's not dead, I shouldn't have said that. She's probably watching right now, he killed me. Sorry, Mom. Freddie, I heard you tell those people I was dead. I'm not dead. I can see it now. My phone's ringing in the truck right now. It is. But my mother, God love her, is tough. And that's her sister who she loves. It's her sister who she loves. So what do you think my mother did? She took the initiative on her own behalf to call my cousins, my aunt's two children, to tell them they weren't taking proper care of their mother. And that if they didn't take care of her sister, she was going to report them because my aunt needed assisted living. My aunt needed people who were trained to take care of her because she couldn't take care of herself. And if they weren't willing to do it, she was going to move hell and high water to make sure somebody would. How do you think that went over? Well, my cousins took her advice and they moved her to a nursing facility in Boston. And they did so because they thought, well, you want us to take care of her? We'll take care of her. Bye-bye. You want to go see her? You can drive. It didn't bother my mother. It didn't bother her sister. They still made the commute to go and see her. My aunt was funny. She loved the fact that her nephew was a priest. She loved the fact that her brother was a priest. And even with her dementia and even with the early onset, you know, Alzheimer's, she still knew I was a priest and she still knew how to find me. My aunt would call the rectory every week and she would introduce herself to my secretary over and over again. And she would say, "My nephew's your priest." And my secretary was going, "Oh, I know, you know, he's a wonderful priest, he's good." And then my aunt would say something, and I don't know why, this is one of these things that sometimes people say, "He's going to bury me someday." Sad, people say that, "You're going to bury me, Father." And I'm like, "Well, don't be in a hurry." You know, I mean, we can do better things than, you know, your funeral. We can have fun now if you want. But my aunt would just say, he's gonna do my funeral mass someday. Well, to make a long story shorter, my aunt passed away. She died. And after my aunt passed away, I can remember, she lived in Shrewsbury, Massachusetts. The pastor of the parish where she was going to be buried out of, his name is Monsignor Mike Rose, he met with her two children, my cousins. And he called me after he met with him, and he said, "Fred, I have some bad news." And I said, "What's that, Mike?" He said, "They don't want you to do the mass." I said, "What?" He said, they don't want you to do it. I said, "Mike, you knew my aunt. She was your aunt loved you." "Well, there's no doubt in my mind that your aunt would want you to do the mass, but they don't want you to do the mass." I said, "All right, I won't do the mass." Now, why didn't they want me to do the mass? Retribution. They had nothing against me. I didn't do anything to them, but my mother did. So now they were going to punish me to get back at her. Now, I told you good people yesterday, I'm Irish and Italian. If you don't think that bothered me, you're wrong. Oh, I was angry. But what was I going to do? And you know what the funny part of it was? You know when all of this transpired? You know when my aunt died? She died during the holy season of Lent. And I can remember being in the church one night praying, because I loved my aunt. I loved her so much. And I can remember being so angry. And I can remember saying to myself, "This isn't fair." And I'm praying. I'm saying, "Why would they be so destructive? Why would they be so malicious? Why would they do this to me when I didn't do anything to them? Why would they treat me like this when I haven't done anything to them?" And after I said it, I thought, "Thank you. What a great gift. During the season of Lent, you've allowed me to experience a glimpse of the passion that you endured for me." That's good theologically and spiritually speaking, isn't it? Do you think it helped me forgive them? In a way. As a priest, if we receive mercy from God, we know that we're expected to extend mercy to other people, but it's not easy. And I don't know what it is about you good people, good faithful Catholics. I love it when you'll tell a priest a story. You'll tell us a story about something that happened, maybe between a sibling, or maybe your husband, or somebody that's wronged you or hurt you. And you'll tell the story with such ferocity, and such excitement, and such passion. And when I watch you tell the story, your face will turn 7 shades of purple, and your voice will fluctuate up and down. And then you'll always end the story when you're talking to a priest with these words, "But I've forgiven him." Now, do you really believe after you do that, that us priests believe that you forgave them? No! So how do you do it? How did I do it? What's the lesson? How do we bestow mercy on those who don't deserve it? Well, that's what mercy is. The first thing you have to do, my friends, and we all have grudges. We all have people that if you call to mind in your mind right now, your skin crawls. That when you see them, you just shudder. And you want to run away. We all have them. And particularly the people who have hurt us and wronged us. What did I do? I said to myself, "Well, listen. They weren't going after me. They were going after my mother through me, which still isn't right. Still makes me angry. But how do I look at them?" Well, the first thing I have to do, if I'm angry with somebody, if you're angry with somebody, is you have to pray for a desire. You always have to ask God for that which you want to receive. If you're having a hard time forgiving someone, be honest with yourself. Be honest with God in the context of your own prayer. Say to him, I don't want to forgive this person. I can't stand this person. I despise this person. But then know that that's not the right disposition. And the first step in forgiveness is praying for the desire to forgive. Because you don't have it. And when you say to the priest after you tell that emphatic story, but I forgave him. No, you didn't. And you don't even possess the desire to forgive. That's what you need to pray for. God, give me the desire to forgive those who I find loveless. Give me the desire to forgive. And then eventually, after much praying, fervent prayer, it might not going to happen overnight. And the timetable depends from person to person, but eventually you will receive the desire and the grace to be able to do that. And then forgiveness can begin to take its course. But if you don't have the desire, you're never going to forgive. If you don't pray for the desire, it's never going to happen. So that's what we have to do, because that's where mercy begins. Give me the desire that comes from your sacred heart, not mine. Because you remember what he said to us. He said it not long ago in the scriptures. It's not from without that defiles. What defiles us comes from our own individual hearts. And that's why Lent is such a beautiful time of year, as Father Brian beautifully articulated at the beginning, because it's an opportunity to transform these hearts into the sacred heart of Jesus Christ, and to love as he loves. We've all been wronged by family members, but I don't think any of us grew up hating our family members. You didn't come out of the womb and go, I hate you people. I hope not. No, something happened. And hopefully for us, there was a time before that happened. And when you're having trouble forgiving somebody, what you have to do is you have to think about the good times. You see, I grew up with my two cousins. They were quite a bit older than me, but I can remember my male cousin. He used to take me to haunted houses. He used to take me into pumpkin patches during Halloween to pick the biggest pumpkin. He would give me candy and buy me presents. He did all kinds of wonderful things. My other cousin, his sister, she was good to me and helped me with homework. I can remember us watching The Wizard of Oz ad nauseum when I was a kid at their house. I can remember the sleepovers we enjoyed together. I can remember him wearing Halloween masks and terrorizing me in the middle of the night. I remember all these good things and all these wonderful, beautiful memories and all the wonderful random acts of kindness they did for me, despite the thing that hurt me. It's a choice. I can focus on who they were that I loved, or I can focus solely on what they did to hurt me. Let me ask you something in lieu of last night. How do you think he looks at us? Do you think he looks at you with judgmental and condemning eyes? Do you think he looks at your faults and your failings? Or does he look at you for who he knows you have the potentiality to become? That's how we have to look at our brothers and sisters in the world. Not with disdain, not with disgust, not with judgmentalism, but with the potentiality for who they have to become. And that leads us to the next step. Once you see the potential that they possess, and we all do by virtue of what I said last night, that we're created in the image and likeness of God, once you see who they are and the potential that they have to become, then you can pray for them and pray that that potential comes to fruition. And don't ever underestimate the value of prayer, my friends. Prayer is the most powerful weapon we have against evil. And prayer is an act of love and mercy, because the people who have hurt us, they don't know we're praying for them. And isn't it perfect during the season of Lent? What do we begin with on Ash Wednesday? Don't let your left hand know what the right is doing. They don't know you're praying for them, but you are. And that's an act of love on your behalf for them. And so for the ones who have hurt us, we pray that they may receive the grace to grow into the people that God has chosen them to be. And to pray for ourselves too. Because if we're honest, what does Lent teach us? What did last night teach us? Then in the end, we're not so different. We're all the same. We're all in need of mercy. We're all in need of those great virtues we talked about tonight. Faith, hope, and love. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Good night.